being here tonight. Amen. Wasn't this morning incredible? I just love water baptism. I love it. My heart just swells every time that I see someone baptized. I don't know why. It makes me want to just get baptized like every single service. Does that do anybody else? Or just me? Anyway, thank you for being here. And thank you for just supporting your church. Amen. And my mom, I haven't had a word back. So they just went to Houston just to do some checks to make sure that everything was okay. So I have not heard on any results or anything like that, but I'm sure she's good. Amen. We trust God. And so just pray for your pastor so he doesn't stress out. But let's stand tonight and just lift our request to Jesus. Amen. He's a God that hears. Lord, we just lift up, Lord, Pastor Brad and Tammy this morning, tonight. Right now, Father, you have them in your hands. You have them in your capable, mighty, healing hands. So, God, we trust you. We trust you. We trust you. We trust you. Lord, I thank you for another opportunity to worship you with a congregation together. I thank you that we can meet so openly. Lord, we can join together in unison and worship your holy name. I pray that, Lord, that you would find true worshipers here tonight. Lord, I ask that you give Selome tonight the words to say. I thank you for such a precious pastor in this house. Lord, we thank you and we ask that you would just have your will and have your reign tonight. In the name of Jesus. And the church said,
amen.
Amen.
Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do.
I believe you will come like the rain, and I believe you will come like the rain. I believe you will come like the rain.
My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do. My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do. My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do.
I believe you will come like the rain, and I believe you will come like the rain, and I believe you will come like the rain.
I believe it,
and I believe you will come like.
You'll come like the rain. You'll come like the rain. remember where I was just singing that song. It reminded me of what Pastor was preaching about, that river of living water. And in Ezekiel, when it was talking about the river and how plants just pop up because of just the life within it. Won't you pray that tonight? God, let your life giving water flow like rain in this place. Open up the floodgates of heaven, God, and fill our hearts. Lord, our soul hunger and thirst for more of you, Jesus. Can we sing that again? My soul longs for you. Go ahead. Sing it. My soul longs.
My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. My soul longs for you. My soul longs for you. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do.
I believe you will come like the rain. And I believe you will come like the rain. And I believe you will come like the rain.
Come like the rain.
Jesus, your all this heart is living for.
Won't you tell him that tonight? Jesus, Lord, your all this heart is living for. God, I will wait for you, and only you. My soul longs for you, God. My soul longs for you.
I want more.
Jesus. Pour out your mercy, Jesus. Lord, we need more of you, especially in this day and time. God, we need it. We can't last in this society without you, Jesus. God, I can't even pump gas without you, Father. God, I need to trust you. I need to trust you that you're going to provide for my every need. And even if you don't, I will still praise you. Because, Father, when we ask for a good thing, you want to give us a good thing. So, Lord, I trust you. Can you say that to him tonight? God, I trust you. I trust you with my finances. I trust you, Jesus. I trust you, God.
Running after me. And all my life. you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will see of the goodness of God.
Sing your goodness.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Your goodness
is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. It's your good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. 'Cause you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Good, good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am.
Just a voice.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
Sing it out.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect. Perfect in all of your ways to us.
Sing it again, you're perfect, God.
Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
You're perfect, Lord.
You are perfect. In all of your ways, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
You're good, good
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You're a good, good Father. It's who he is, church. It's who he is. Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
You know, he doesn't make mistakes. Lord, you don't make mistakes. We can trust you. We can trust this God. Before Pastor Selome comes up, won't you lift your hands one more time and just say, God, I surrender to you. Lord, I can trust that you are perfect in your ways. So, Lord, let your word be a lamp into my feet and a light into my path. Guide me into all truth. Shut the lies of the enemy when he tries to talk and say my name. Lord, let me hear your voice so loud and clear tonight. Jesus, I trust you. I trust you, Father. I trust you, Jesus. God, you don't make mistakes. So hold us in your hand tonight. Hold us in your mighty hand tonight. You're a mighty God. You're a mighty God. You are mighty, 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 mighty God. Can we just sing to him? You are a mighty, 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 mighty God. Just sing about his character. You are mighty, 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 mighty God. You are a mighty, 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 mighty God. Sing, you're an awesome God.
You are an awesome, 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 awesome God. You are an awesome, 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 awesome God.
You are an
awesome, 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 awesome God.
You're holy,
you're holy, 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 holy God.
You are a
holy, 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 holy God.
You are a
holy, 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 holy God.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are. I can trust you. I can trust you. I can trust you. I can trust you, God. God, I just pray that faith would rise up. Faith would rise up in your believers tonight. Lord, that we can trust you. We can trust you, God. God, oh, I can trust you, trust. trust you, God. I can trust you, God. Lord, we trust you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that we can trust your word. And when you speak, God, we are listening tonight. So open up our hearts, God. Open up our ears. It's always my prayer every time I sit in a service like this. When someone is delivering a message, that God, won't you let me be a doer? Let me be a doer tonight of your word that I hear. Let me be a doer of the words that I even sing. Lord, because if I'm not a doer, all of this is just filthy rags to you. So Lord, I want something to bring. I want something to lay down at your feet that you can use. So Lord, help us be doers, not just hearers of your word, Jesus. Jesus, in your name, we declare all these things. Your name, Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You'll trust this God. Amen. We can trust him tonight. Amen. We just, I have a quick update on Tammy. She is, they were testing to, you know, in the ER, if you don't know. But all the tests came back good. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So she's going to follow up tomorrow with the cardiologist. So keep her in prayer. Amen. So today, I'm filling in Pastor Brad's shoes. It's very hard to fill his shoes, huh? But we're going to talk about the vision of the church. And he wanted to talk about that. And actually, in fact, we cover this in the leadership retreat that we do every year with our leaders. We talk about the pillars of the vision and the mission statement. So we're going to dive into that tonight. If you haven't seen it or heard it, or if it's been a while, then it'll be a reminder. Amen. And I really had an awesome time this morning with the message that we heard about the river, the water. Hallelujah. Amen. And that is the number one word in the vision that we have, is an encounter. And we'll get to it. And in fact, in Sunday school, we were talking about what Bethany was just singing, being my soul thirsts for you in Psalm 42, right? It says, as the deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for you, O God. And David was that man that always wanted God, that always desired, that always just was thirsty. Amen. And that is, and I believe kind of our pastor is kind of like that. He's a worshiper like David, and he's always thirsting after the Holy Spirit and the river. And thank God for Pastor Brad and Pastor Tammy. Thank God. I thank God for them every day. Man, are y'all not thankful for them? Amen. We thank God. I thank God for them every day. Okay, so I wanted to start with just a quick, you know, sort of the definition, or sort of kind of an introduction to a mission of the church. So the mission statement of the church states why the local body exists, right? Why does it exist? That is, you know, it's supposed to define, or it should define, or it defines why we exist as a body. Before a local church makes plans to reach out its own community, the group really must understand its mission. The primary source of source for clarity on the church's mission during any age or any location in the world is the Book of Acts. Actually, the Book of Acts is our example. That's what we follow, right? They had a mission. So they had us, you know, they had to set a goal. We got to know where we're going, right? And that's the direction that everybody, okay, so we want to go from point A to point B, and everybody's on the same page. We understand, and how we go about it are just the little details in between. So if you go to the next slide, the New Testament church mission, they had four ingredients, and it's written actually in Acts 2, verse 42, actually 42 to 47. They had four main ingredients that shaped the mission of the first century church. So I won't read it all, but we'll just go over these four points right here. Every day they continued to meet together. That was one of their, you know, the things they did. They continued to meet together in the temple courts. And they were worshipers. Amen. Worship is an integral part of who we are as people. Amen. The people gathered corporately in worship, as well as to house back then. And it was more than an event on a Sunday, right? Worship was an attitude of life. Amen. It's an attitude of life. Worshiping, when we say yes to Jesus in our everyday walk, that is our worship to Him. Amen. When we say yes to Jesus in every decision that we're making, when we say no to the things that we know we need to shun away, the Bible says, shun away from evil, run away from the evil, right? When we say yes, that is our worship unto God. It's not just singing, right? It's not just music. Worship is a lifestyle and honoring God. But they did gather in the homes and they worshiped together. And then the other thing they did was number two is all believers were together and had everything in common. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. Now, I know that this is probably not a reality for us today. We have to work. We probably won't be able to meet every day. But you could see that the priority that they had for that, right? They had a higher priority in getting together with the brothers. They broke bread together in their homes and ate together with gladness and with sincere hearts. And so that's important, to be as sincere with one another, to break bread, to prioritize being together. And that's commitment to the biblical fellowship. It's also an attitude of serving one another. The lifestyle of early believers reflected the kingdom of God. This is the key to life, health, and a clear knowledge of who and what we are as the body of Christ today. So many Christians need to experience what biblical relationship is all about. It's kind of like marriage, right? Like, you know, if, you know, your husband and wife, if it's just a husband that's giving and that's doing, and the wife just takes, it gets kind of tired, or vice versa later on, right? Like, it kind of down the road, the relationship kind of doesn't wouldn't be as good it can be, as good as it can be. So it's kind of like that. Is I think having an attitude as a church member, as a body, we ought to have an attitude of what can I do instead of what can I get. What was the last time the church did something for me, right? And so having an attitude of giving and serving one another, amen. The words one another occurs about 108 times in the New Testament. That is a lot. The Christian life is a community lifestyle. I mean, we do that a lot here, right? We have a lot going on. We pray for one another. We minister to one another. We serve one another. We love one another. Believers are people who give themselves to one another. So that is another ingredient that they had, you know, in the early church. That's point number two. And point number three, the fourth ingredient, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the following, and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. And that's growth among the disciples. That's how they could grow. Right? Yes, they came to the Lord. They came to the understanding of who Jesus Christ was. They came to the fellowship. But then they had to get devoted to what? To the study of the word and to the prayer. And that is what's going to usher the growth. And that's kind of what the early church did. And then what happened? Once they did that, and the Lord added to their numbers daily, to those who were being saved. So once people came to faith in Jesus Christ, the church has the responsibility to help develop these believers, amen, and their walk with God. We've had several people who have come to the Lord the last few weeks, and so it's all of our responsibility as a body of Christ, especially those mature ones, to take those under our wings, to teach and to mentor and to help disciple, amen, and to pray for them, because, you know, the enemy is going to come and yup in their ears. You know, it's like, what did you just do? You know, this is not doable. You can't live this life. You know, no, that's a lie. And, you know, we need as a body of Christ to come together and come against us, against that, and advise and counsel and teach and be that love, that they can see the love of Jesus, right, emanating from us. Hallelujah. So the next slide, so I'll just talk a little bit about the mission of the Assemblies of God, right? You know, just to kind of, by the way, the Assemblies of God does have a mission statement. It says the Assemblies of God is committed to fulfilling, it's, by the way, based on the book of Acts, where I just read the four ingredients. One is evangelizing the lost, worship God, that's number two, and disciple believers, we just talked about that, and then showing compassion. I mean, showing compassion, helping the poor, but all of that accumulating, really finding the loss, amen, finding the loss and bringing them to Jesus. So by our mission, by focusing, we can fulfill what we desire to fulfill, amen, and that's the key to a mission or vision. Peter gave the mission of the first century in Acts 2:42-47 from the day of Pentecost, when 3,000 were added to the church. That body of believers was able to turn their world upside down, right? Amen? And because of their drive, the known world was declared Christian by the end of the first century. How did they do that? Because by defining the mission and focusing on the fulfillment of it. All right. You're with me so far, right? Amen. Okay. So now we're going to the Angleton Central Assembly of Missions statement. This says to provide opportunity to encounter. The mission is to provide an opportunity to what? To encounter God's presence so profoundly that lives are changed and released back into the community as agents of change. Amen? As agents of change. At the end, why we coming in here and experiencing the presence of God, you know, getting that encounter, you know, when we come to the house of God and we encounter the Spirit of the living God, what happens to us? Right? In the midst of the worship, we begin to understand the love of God even more, the mercy, what God had done, his goodness. You know, when Moses prayed and he said, show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. And I want to quickly read that. You don't have to go to it, but let me find it. I think it's Exodus chapter 34. It always amazes me. Yeah, 34 verse 5. After Moses asked him on the previous chapter in 33, asked the Lord, Lord, I want to see your glory. And in chapter 34, God comes and in verse 5, he says, now the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And this is God revealing himself to man, Moses. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious. Merciful and gracious. You know, that is the first thing God spoke to Moses, that he is merciful. He didn't say, he's many things, but he said he is merciful. Amen. That's how God, and when we encounter the glory of God, when we really encounter him, we feel and we understand him, his mercy for us. We understand where and how he brought us, his goodness. You know, and the same thing in the temple of Solomon, when they're dedicating that temple, they stood and they started worshiping God. I think it's in 2 Chronicles. And they began to sing and to worship God. I want to go to it really quickly. When Solomon had made an end of praying, they were dedicating this temple that they had built, the fire came down from heaven, thank you, and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house, and the priests could not enter into the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. And when all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground upon the pavement and worshiped and praised the Lord, saying, "For he is good. He is good, for his mercy endureth forever." What did God say to Moses? "I'm merciful and gracious," right? That's how he revealed himself in the beginning. Now, you see it again when people were hit by this glory that came upon that temple. The first thing they saw was the glory. His mercy endures forever. His goodness, hallelujah, his goodness becomes so real to us. So we are on the pillar of the mission. Okay, there you go. So the four pillars of the mission. Encounter is the first one, to create an atmosphere charged with the life-changing presence of God. Amen. And the next one is evidence. We're going to look at them individually. But to challenge every believer to walk so close with God that they begin to look and act like him. Amen. They begin to look and act like him. Engagement is the task of discipleship. And all of these are the ingredients we just read in the book of Acts. The task of discipleship is not complete until every believer is fully functioning in their gifts and calling to reach, teach, and equip others. An environment, the church, is a community, a family, a multifaceted organism that each cell draws strength from. Apart from community, the individual cells will die. In fact, Pastor wanted to pass this out, if you would help me, please. These are the four pillars that we're going to cover tonight. So encounter, everything meaningful and relevant in this community flows from the encountering the life of Jesus, the life-changing presence of God. Therefore, each gathering of community of faith must provide time and space for such an encounter. That's why we take our time and worship. And that's why you see that we have programs, we have things that we have lined up to do in services. But you see that we give a lot of time for what the Holy Spirit wants to do during the service, right? And there's plenty of times that, you know, Pastor Brad had brought word to preach, but that wasn't the direction, right? The Lord was doing things. And so because he has to have his way, right? This is his church. He, you know, when we let him have his way, then he knows how to grow the church. He knows how to deal with people's heart. It might be that we have, you know, been prepared to come preach or do something else on the program, but he might have another idea. And we must let him be. Amen. We must allow him to work through hearts. The encounter is so important because you will never be the same. Like Pastor Brad said this morning, there's a change that will happen in the inside of us that we will not be the same. It just won't be the same because there's that thing that was dead that became alive. There was something that was junk or dirty that we now no longer are experiencing. We don't live in that anymore. There's just a transformation. We have been taken from the darkness into the light that we are able to see now. We are able to thirst and want this God, the living God. Now we begin to understand when the Bible says the heavens declares your glory. We were talking about that this morning. When we think about how God is so big that he reigns forever. You know, it won't just be words that are being said, but there is a revelation, a rhema, an understanding of who God is. And that happens in an encounter. You know, we could be coming to church. We can be going home. We could be just doing things like on a ritual basis. But if there isn't that encounter, I was talking to my sister the other day, and I was sharing with her what I was meditating on last week, which was Psalms 42, which says what I said, as the deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for this God. And it says, my God, he said, I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty of this God, oh, the living God. Where shall I appear before God? That's what David was saying in Psalm 42. And I was sharing this with her, and I was just sensing the desire that David had to be with this God. It seemed like, you know, if you read that chapter all the way down, it says, why are you cast down, my soul? Why are you cast down? Why are you all of a sudden down? Remember those days where I used to go up the mountain, the Zion's out, I was singing with other people. Like, he was trying to remember where he was at, but he wasn't in that place of where he was experiencing the river anymore, but he was going back to it, and he's asking, Lord, I am thirsty of that. And so I was sharing this with her, and I'm like, you know, this is where we need to live. If we ever stop thirsting for this river, thirsting for this God, like really desiring him with everything that we have in us, that we need to stop and think there's something wrong. I got to stop right here. Like, it doesn't matter, right, what I do, right? Our ministry, you know, what we do for God is not more than what we can be for him. Amen? It's an overflow. Ministry is an overflow of our relationship with him. So when that is not flowing, then we got to just hit the brake and say, Lord, what's going on? And so anyway, so I was sharing with her about this verse, and she said, you know, what I don't know. And we both grew up in the same home. My mom raised us, you know, in church. And she said, like, I don't know if I get that. And I said, so good that you're saying that, because you could say, yeah, I know, because you've heard it so many times. You know how many times we heard a verse, we can say, yeah, I know what you mean. I've heard of that verse. But she said, no, I really want to get it. Like, you know what I thirst? She said, I thirst going to these conferences, the Holy Spirit moves, and I have an encounter with the Lord. And I've seen God work in those environments. And so I thirst for that. But then when I think about what David is saying about just having that, this morning when I was sharing this, the deer is one. He was not in, with. He wasn't, this wasn't, you know, a situation where you're in church. Yes, you're encountering God in church. But then she said, I don't know that secret place by myself. I don't have that. I don't thirst. Like, I don't get what David is saying. And I said, well, you can start right there. You could just right there, you can go to your room and say, Lord, I don't know what this is talking about. And I want to experience this. I want to talk to you. I want to flow in this river into my own closet. I want to sit in that place where I hear and I drink from you. You know, Gabby shared this in the beginning of this year when Martha and Mary and what Jesus said, that Mary chose the one thing that she needed to choose, the one thing that is good. That is where, you know, she sat by the feet of Jesus, and she was encountering him with the word of God, with the words that was coming out of his mouth. She was just drinking that. She didn't want to do anything else. Martha was busy serving, but she wanted that encounter. She wanted to sit there and have that encounter. You know, I know that there isn't, like, this corporate anointing. This is where the blessing was ordered. Like the Bible says in 133, right, where the brothers are sitting in unity. And it goes on, it talks about the oil, and that at the end it says, there his order, everlasting blessing. There's a special corporate anointing when we come together, and we must thirst for that, and we must be part of that. But then there's also that place of that private place that you and I must cultivate with him. Amen. In that place, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty God. And I will say of the Lord, I. See, that I has to come, be birthed out of our spirit, that I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, and my God I will trust. You know, it won't just be a word when we encounter him, because words are words. They'll just fly by. But when they become real, when we encounter him, that I will trust in him, that he is my shield, his truth will guide me. You know, it's not easy when we are facing with, you know, trials and tribulations, when if we, you know, to say that if we don't already have that encounter, and that faith is already built within us. And that we look at that giant like David does, and he said, who is this Philistine? Uncircumcised Philistine. And he's looking at the same giant that everybody is running away from, but that thing wasn't scaring him because he knew his God. And the place to know him is in the secret place. Amen. And the enemy will fight you and I every time we want to go there. Because he knows there's power in there. There's power in waiting. Hallelujah. He that dwelleth in the secret place. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. If we feel weak, we got to go to that place where we can be strengthened. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like the eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. They will be running around. They'll be serving. And then they'll be doing things and you're like, where is this coming? Well, there's a river. There's a river. There's going. They're sitting. They're getting. There's power. There's some power that's coming from the Most High. Hallelujah. Right above that scripture where it says, they that wait upon the Lord, he said, have you not known, have you not heard? The everlasting God, the creator of all the universe, neither faints, because he doesn't faint. He's not tired. And he says he gives power to those who need it, who are weak. And he gives you might. Hallelujah. We need might. We can't do anything. I was telling them this morning, like, we cannot live this life without that encounter every day, because then we're going to depend on our own strength, and our strength will fail us every time. Hallelujah. So I think I stayed on this one for long enough, so I'll move on to the next one. So encounter in church, encounter at home. But remember, church begins at home. Hallelujah. So next one is evidence. So that has to be a result that comes from an encounter. So for that encounter to be something of worth, if we've come here, we've taken our time to come to the church, we've taken our time to do the things that, you know, the things of the Lord, whether that's coming to church, whether that's coming, you know, doing serving or what have you. If we're, you know, we might as well bring a result, right? So we want to bring, there's got to be an evidence. There's got to be an evidence. There's got to be a result that shows that we actually have been touched, and there's a change in our life. There's evidenced by changed life. To facilitate such a change, the one mission of the church is to focus the believer's attention to the Word of God. Amen. We can have an encounter here or at home, but then we got to go and feed that with the Word of God, by the preaching of the Word of God, the teaching of the Word, and encouraging the reading and application of the Word. So there's this verse that we use when we teach the couples class. It's Proverbs 24, y'all remember. It's the wisdom. The house is built upon wisdom. Amen. A home is built up, and when a home is built upon wisdom, then there is life that comes. There's fruitfulness that comes from that. And wisdom, we said, is applied knowledge. And knowledge by itself is, like I said, it's not. It's a revelation knowledge that will actually shift things into something different. Like, you know, we will change something in us. If we just know the Word of God, just to know it, it's not going to do anything, right? But if there is a revelation knowledge, there is a shift that will take place in our spirit. We'll actually turn around and say, no, this is the way I used to do it, but this is the way I'm going to do it. And there's power that comes with it, because the Word of God is alive. It's living, as it says in Hebrew, right? It is sharper than a double-edged sword. It changes. It transforms how we think. It transforms how we see things. So as the Word of God comes, so as we're encountering the Holy Spirit, but then we go home, we come to church, we hear the Word of God, we meditate on the Word of God, and we apply it. And we ask the Lord, you know, in Ezekiel it says that I will cause you to walk in my statutes. That is my hope. Isn't it yours? That I don't have to. Like, God, if I would allow him, he would actually help me walk uprightly. Hallelujah. I would actually, you know, he'll help me apply the Word. Amen? And that is wisdom. Hallelujah. So that is the second pillar, which is evidence, a life changed by the encounter. And that change comes by the Word of the living God. Amen. Because faith is birthed within us. If we have faith, then we're able to walk in what we've heard and what we've believed. And faith comes by what? Everybody should be able to quote this. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of the living God. So if the Word is within us, then that Word, that revealed Word, will bring faith in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Scripture says in 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says, but we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as the Spirit of the Lord. That's in 2 Corinthians 3:18. There is that transformation. There is that going from glory to glory, amen, that happens as we have been unveiled, right? That once we have come to the Lord and we know that Jesus is the Lord of our life, then we begin this journey with Jesus. It's that veil has been taken off. Those of you who've just come to the Lord in the last few weeks, if you're here, You know, something has been taken off. Like, you're seeing things in a different way now. And so begin to walk in that. Don't lose the excitement, the joy of your salvation. You know, there's this joy that's probably bubbling inside you. The knowing this thing that you've probably never knew that existed. But indulge in that. Cultivate that by coming to the church and fellowshipping and praying and reading the Word of God. Amen. The third one is engagement. Engagement, the third E. The third pillar. Engagement is the one mission of the church, is a response of every true believer to a God encounter. To a God encounter. Service to God in the church is privilege. It's in your handout that we gave out. Service to God in the church is a privilege and an honor. It is not a right or a territory we own. Jesus said, the last shall be first, first shall be last. Self-promotion is spiritual witchcraft. So it, you know, so there's an encounter, and there's evidence that there is an there's been an encounter. The next thing is a life that's already been touched, a life that's changed by the encounter, will begin to think, okay, what can I do for this God? Right? It's an overflow that comes from our relationship with Him. What can I do to this God, for this God? Where can I serve Him? Where's because there's going to be a calling, a purpose that's already in you, in us, that's created, like a desire that's created to serve Him. And then that's the engagement part. But we got to know that it is an honor and a privilege to serve Him. Amen. And God gives gifts to the body of Christ, amen. And it's in Ephesians that God gives gifts, the pastor, the teachers, the apostles. And then there's the nine gifts, the healing gift, the word of wisdom, knowledge, and that's in 1 Corinthians 12:4. All of that gets cultivated in the process of the reading of the word and prayer and fellowship and growing as we mature in Christ. All of that gets cultivated. Hallelujah. So the last one, am I doing in time? Oh, pretty good. It's environment. Man without air will die. A fish out of water will die. A rose submerged in the water will die. And a Christian living outside a Christian community will die. And so it's so crucial. That we really get this. I mean, I know most of you here tonight, you understand this. That's probably why you're here. But it's such an, you know, sometimes it says here in Hebrews 10, 25, it says, do not neglect. Sometimes we get weary, right? But it says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is. But exhorting one another and so much the more as you see the day approaching. We are commanded, we are asked to come together because there is power, there is corporate anointing, there's just that amazing energy. I don't even know what to call it. It's just mysterious for me in how we just get so encouraged from one another when we come to the house of God because we're one body. Amen. And, you know, even you may not be saying hi to everybody, but even just seeing them blesses you, right? Like, I see Brother Pat sitting there, Myrtle, and sometimes I don't get to say hi to him, but just knowing that he's there blesses me. Amen. We bless one another by even our presence. And that is beautiful. And that is the beauty of the community. We help one another. We pray for one another. When one's down, the other one is lifting. That was the church of the first century, the first church in Acts. And that is what we need to be now and what we are, we strive to be. No, but no church is perfect. I mean, I don't think there's ever been a perfect church. But this is where we strive to go, right? To become a family, a community that who can lean on one another, who can depend on each other's prayer, that truly will love one another, to forgive one another, amen. And understanding that we all have our own shortcomings, and we just extend grace to one another, amen. And that is the beauty and the power of being a community. In Psalm 133, it says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edge of his garments. It's like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to be a part of that as much as I can. Amen. Be a part of that blessing that He ordered in whenever the brothers are sitting in unity. Hallelujah. And then in Ephesians 5:19, it says, "Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God, the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in fear of God. Hallelujah. Amen. And this is the last one, I believe. I don't have another slide, but this is the mission of the church. Like Pastor said, we already do, but it's now, you know, it's been written that you have it in your hands. And as a body of Christ, when we understand the vision, is to encounter the Lord, to grow and have an evidence to show a change, and to engage, and then to outflow. Actually, as part of the environment, I'm sorry to, yeah, I forgot to mention that, is to reach the community, the Christian community. So as we come together and as we are one, that's when we can actually reach out to the community, right? That's an overflow of what we're doing here, is to reach the lost, the broken, the hurt, the ones that need to see, to find Jesus. Amen. There's a lot of people who are looking for what we have, and they just don't think this is what they need yet. But we have to pray them in. We have to love them in. And we have to do these things so that we can do that. Amen. That was what the disciples did. They ate together. They fellowshiped. They prayed together. They read the word of God together. They worshiped together. And after that, he added, amen, added to their fellowship the saved ones. In one day, 3,000 when Peter preached. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Please stand to your feet and we can. Hallelujah. Is Bethany here or she's left? Oh, you're here. Okay. Brian is here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. God is good. He is good. We are blessed to be in this house where the Spirit of the living God flows so freely. And that I don't remember a time where I have been in this house where I just, you know, the Lord just shows up every time as he promised. Hallelujah. And it's not about feeling. We know that it's true. The truth, the word of God says, if you're gathered in my name, I am here. So he is here. So what do we have to say to him tonight? What do we have to say to him tonight? Let's pray and ask him if has it been a while since we've really indulged in the river, have encountered him? Has the word become dull to us? Or has it been a while since we truly, really had that communion with him? And this is why we're here, is to help one another, to pray for one another, to get us into that place where we encounter him. Therefore, we can be changed. Therefore, we can be engaged and then flow to the community. Be a blessing to those who need us so desperately. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We give you praise and we honor you tonight. We worship you, Lord. Thank you for your presence. Thank you that you love us. Thank you that you've made the way, that we have become the children of the Most High, and that we have access to the throne of the living God, that we can come boldly asking for grace. Thank you, Father. We worship you this evening. We adore you. We bless your holy name. Lord, I pray that you touch every heart tonight, that you will remove every burden, that you will renew and strengthen your people, that you would empower us, that we will walk in your ways, that we will say yes every morning, that we will cry out to you in every situation, that we will trust in you, O God. Jesus, heal those that need healing tonight. Heal the brokenhearted. Heal the one, Father. Heal the one that is confused and broken. I pray for every sickness to leave tonight. Lord, you touch us one more time tonight. I pray, Father, if there is a soul in here that don't know you, that he or she will encounter you, Lord, that you reveal yourself, that your love becomes so real, that the story of the cross becomes so real, that the blood of Jesus washes us all from our sin. I thank you, Jesus. If you're in here and you don't know Jesus, that you don't really walk with him, just talk to him, ask him, Lord, I want to live my life with you. I don't want to live one day without knowing this encounter, this fellowship with you. Come be the Lord of my life. Come be the Savior of my life. Help me live for you. Tell him that, church. Tell him, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Altars are open. Thank you, Jesus.
Out of me, I give it all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. I lean not on my own understanding, my life of the maker of heaven. I lean not on my own understanding. My life is in your hands, of the maker of heaven. I give it all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. I give it all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. And I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. This mountain with my hands wide open, I will climb this mountain with my hands. I lean not all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. I give it all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. I lean not on my own understanding. My life is in the hands of the maker of heaven. I not on my own understanding. My life is in the hands of the maker of heaven. I give it all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. I give it all to you, God, trusting that you'll make something beautiful out of me. And I will climb this mountain with my hand wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open.
gentle with my hands. There's nothing I'll hold on to, nothing I'll hold on to, nothing I'll hold on to but you. There's nothing I'll hold on to, nothing I'll hold on to, nothing I'll hold on to but you. I lean not on my own understanding. My life is in the hands of the Maker of heaven. I lean not on my own understanding. My life is in the hands of the Maker of heaven. I give it all to you, God. Trust and let you make something beautiful out of me. I give it all to you, God. Trust and let you make something beautiful out of me.
And